Steve Miller. I want to talk about Cher.
Oh boy.
One day I was thinking about you, and I don't know how the whole conversation came about, but this was several months ago, and I went, was Les married to Cher? And I didn't know. So I looked up Cher in Google, and it blew my mind. The list of boyfriends and husbands that came up. It was just an unbelievable list. You were number three, by the way.
No, I was
this huge. I don't mean you were number three in succession, but on this huge list of people that included movie stars and people, you were still as number three on that list. So I said, that's some testament to your notoriety.
We had fun. We had some fun. You know.
Tell me about it. How'd you meet her?
Well. I was at the Rainbow one night. You know what that is.
Yep.
A friend of mine, Richard T. Bear, said, "Hey, Les, Cher is holding some auditions down at, I guess, the old Columbia lot, you know. And why don't you come down with me, man?" I said, "Oh." And, you know, I just done a big tour with Kansas, and we had a band called DFK, Dudek, Finnegan, and Krieger. Jim Krieger, we just disagree for
a minute.
And Finnegan was, you know, they were both with Dave Mason for a good time, and of course Finnegan played with everybody, but so we were on a hiatus, you know, and I'm just like hanging out, you know, So yeah, let's go down and hang out with Cher for a minute. So I get down there, and who shows up? But Mike Finnegan and Stephen Stills, they show up, you know, so we just turn it into this one big jam session, you know, and Cher just goes, "That's it, stop, you know." She stopped everybody. She says, "Look, you know, I rented this thing because I need some help. I want to put a rock and roll album out, you know." And she had about three or four producers. You know, it was just a mess, you know. And so, so she says, "Well, look, here it is. You know, all you people that are interested in helping me do a record, meet me down at Nick's Fish Market, right on Sunset, right there." So we all went down there. She treated us all to dinner. We had a good time and hung out, and I thought that was going to be the end of it, actually. But then she came up to me. She goes, "So, are you really interested in helping me do a record?" And I said, "Well, you know, yeah. I mean, I'm not doing anything, but I think you need a little bit more organization with it because it's everywhere, you know." And so she said, "Well, let me come to your house and we'll talk about it." And I said, "Okay, sure, come on over." So we talked about it, and I just explained it to her. I just worked with James Newton Howard, you know, and Andy Johns, you know, on the DFK album. And of course, James is amazing, you know. And so I said, "You know, that would be a good producer for you, you know. And then we could start checking out your tunes, and, you know, just doing it the right way, you know, like digging through it, you know." And so she says, "So then you want to help me do it?" I said, "Yeah, I'll help you do it." Which really pissed off Columbia Records when I did that, because she was on Casablanca, you know. And little did I know they're going to get upset about it. I mean, I'm on a hiatus. I'm not doing anything, and everybody's played on everybody's records before.
Yeah.
But anyway, there were some undertones there. But anyway, we ended up doing, you know, getting it done. We cut Black Rose. It was called Black Rose, you know. And of course, her management, you know, was really more into her doing Vegas, because that was their money tree right there, you know, and that's where she made her ducks. And so they were really not interested in anything about Black Rose. Neil Bogart, on the other hand, was with Casablanca, you know, so we did that, and I think that he had Donna Summer and Gene Simmons with Kiss, you know.
Also one of Cher's boyfriends.
Yes, that I was going to say. I was after Gene. So anyway, you know, we did it, and we did a couple of, you know, we did a small tour, we did some TV, we did my Midnight Special, we hosted it and all that. Actually, it was one of the biggest rating ones because she hosted it. You know?
That's great.
But she didn't want to lend her name to it. It was just Black Rose, you know, so. But anyway, we did that, and it just, when Neil Bogart died, suddenly, then we had no support. So a lot of people say that the critics, you know, chewed it up and this and that, which a lot of them did. But But there was a lot of validity to that act too. There was a lot of good players in that band, so
yeah,
and good tunes and everything. And she was really, you know, putting her heart out. So anyway, and then while we were doing that, we just sort of kind of started a little relationship there, you know. And you know, I think there was one time we were in the shower. I'll tell you this one. She goes,
I feel like Howard Stern all of a sudden here now. But she goes, go for it.
She goes, so what do you think, Les? Well, why do you think we're together? You know, and I just said, well, here's the way I look at it. You know, I'm just a hippie from the 60s. You're a chick from the valley, and we're just hanging out with each other until something else better comes along, right? She goes, good answer, LD. Can you get my back? You know, so that was
that's
that.
Good.
You know, and so we hung out for, you know, actually hung out for about 3 years.
So that was a good long relationship.
To the point to where she was now, she's like going, what am I going to do? You know, and I said, well, don't you see it? I mean, you did the Sonny and Cher show. You did your show, you know. I mean, a lot of TV stuff and everything. You've done Buku Records and different, you know, mostly she's got her disco audience, but anyway. But I said, you know, your next thing is movies, man. You should be a movie star. You know, she goes, you think? I said, yeah. So we ended up getting on a plane. We flew to New York and met up with Robert Altman, and that's when she got the part for Back to the Five and Dime, Jimmy uh-huh. Dean, Jimmy Dean. And, you know, she started, you know, developing that. She did Silkwood after that with Meryl Streep. And then one day, you know, we'd split company at that point. And one day out of the blue, I get this call from Cher. She goes, Celeste, she goes, come up to the house. I got something to talk to you about. And I said, well. And so she says, look, you know, I'm doing this new movie. And we're looking for a guy that's got long hair and plays guitar and rides a motorcycle. Do you know anybody like that? I said, stop it. And so she says, look, I opened the door and now go talk to Peter Bogdanovich and get the part. And so she let me read the script, and I actually wrote a song for it, for the theme song. So when I went to with a meeting with Peter, he says, so what part? You know, because I told him I read the script. So, well, where do you see yourself in the movie? I said, well, Gar, you know, Sam Elliott's part. You know, well, we already casted that, you know. But we see you as like Bone, you know, like, you know, would you like that? I said, sure, man, I'm, you know, anything I could do. It was just a learning experience. I never really aspired to be an actor or any of that. I just, you know, and I think it was her way of just throwing something back at me because she was really having fun doing movies at that
point. Yeah.
So it worked out. It's a good thing.
That's great. That's a super story.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody wants to know about Cher and you.
We had fun.
That's really great. What else did we miss?